Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. Oh, praise to the God of laughter, whose humor sends ripples through even the river of death, who turns a mustard seed into a tree. Here in the fun house, the popular routes lead me in circles, but the dead ends have doors. God of signs and wonders, you have revealed to us that Jesus Christ is your Son and our Savior. Strengthen our faith that we may have life in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. God has been made known to us in deeds of power, signs, and wonders, and will not abandon us if we confess the truth about our lives. Let us join together in our prayer of confession. God of joy, we know that you have blessed us richly, yet so often you have abandoned us for silly little disappointments. You have given us Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, and promised us eternal life. But we act as though we don't know it. Forgive us, God. Keep us mindful that you always have and that your promises were true joy in every circumstance, and life forever. Amen. Christ is raised from the dead. Love wins. Hallelujah.
Christ lives and reigns for us. Hallelujah.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. And now let us each go to God in silent prayer with what is on our hearts. Savior God, you gifted us with the Holy Spirit as our advocate and guide. Open us to the Spirit's breath. Carry us on the wings of your wisdom. Set us on the solid foundation of your word, read and proclaimed. May we hear the truth you intend for us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading is from the book of Psalms. It is Psalm 126. So let us listen for what God is saying to us through these words. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them." The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses in the Negev. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying their sheaves. And then turning to the book of Acts, we hear a brief description of the early church and life in it. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A pastor was speaking to a group of second graders about the resurrection of Jesus when one of the students asked, "What did Jesus say when he came out of the grave?" Well, the pastor had to explain that the Gospels don't tell us what Jesus said. Well, the hand of one little girl shot up. She said, "I know what he said. He said, ta-da!" An atheist was spending a quiet day fishing on Loch Ness. Suddenly, the boat was attacked by that legendary monster. In one easy flip, the beast tossed the man and the boat high up in the air. Then it opened its mouth to swallow both. As the man tumbled head over heels in the air, he cried out, "Oh my God, help me!" At once, the ferocious attack froze in place. Time stood still with the atheist suspended in midair. Then a booming voice came down from the clouds. "I thought you didn't believe in me." "Come on, God, give me a break," the man pleaded. "2 minutes ago, I didn't believe in the Loch Ness Monster either." A man came home from church with 2 black eyes. His wife takes one look at him and exclaims, "How in the world did you get two black eyes at church. Well, the man answered, when we stood up to pray, I noticed that the woman in front of me had the back of her dress tucked into her pantyhose. I didn't want to embarrass her by telling her, so I just reached forward and pulled it out. She turned around and punched me in the eye. Okay, that explains one black eye, said the wife. So how did you get the other one? I thought she must have wanted it there, so I put it back. A man and a woman were married for many years. Whenever there was a confrontation, yelling could be heard deep into the night. The old man would shout, "When I die, I will dig my way up and out of the grave and come back and haunt you for the rest of your life." Well, the neighbors feared him, and the old man liked the fact that he was feared. He finally died at the ripe old age of 98. After the burial, her neighbors, who were concerned for her safety, asked the wife, "Aren't you afraid that he might indeed be able to dig his way out of the grave and haunt you for the rest of your life?" The wife said, "Let him dig. I had him buried face down, and I know he won't ask for directions." Now, I'm not psychic, but I can guess what you may be thinking right now. Some of you are wondering, what's going on? Is this a sermon? And others of you are probably thinking, Marianne, don't give up your day job. Well, if you look at the sermon title for today, it's Latin. I never took Latin, so I have to kind of depend on other people translating for me, but risus translates into the English word laughter, and Paschalis is Easter. So when you put those two words together, it says Easter laughter. Now, with the preparation and busyness for Holy Week and the seriousness born out of Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, and the solemn approach to the tomb early Easter Sunday, there was little room for joy leading up to Easter. But that solemnity, however, was transformed into rejoicing with the news that he is risen on Easter morning. The celebration did not cease Sunday, but instead flowed over into Monday. The Monday after Easter, sometimes referred to as Easter Monday, became a day of rejoicing, laughter, and merriment. Perhaps because the clergy, after a long Holy Week, could finally have a break. Now, this practice goes back as far as AD 385, and it was mentioned by St. Gregory of Nyssa. Early Christian leaders who celebrated Risus Paschalis often told jokes, uplifting, lighthearted stories in the day following Easter. There's a publication called the Joyful Newsletter, and the website tells us that God does have a sense of humor. And it was God who had the last laugh when people went to the tomb that Easter morning. Surprise! He's not dead. Jesus is risen. The tomb is empty. Now, many traditions sprang up, including pranks and jokes, to help people lighten up. Reminders not to be so serious. However, in the 17th century, Pope Clement X promptly put an end to all the tomfoolery, and he banned Risus Paschalis. However, over the last few decades, this crisis has risen from the grave. And in the post-resurrection season of Eastertide, we are laughing once again. Remembering to have a good laugh is not a matter of being disrespectful. And the last thing we as Christians want to do is to be perceived as humorless. God clearly has a sense of humor. Just look at the duck-billed platypus. Moles, foals. Yeah. We see God's sense of humor in those creatures. Sometimes we need to hold a mirror up to ourselves to see when we are taking things too seriously. For instance, a priest had a chance encounter with Groucho Marx once in Montreal. The priest extended his hand and said, "I want to thank you for all the joy you've put into this world." Well, Groucho Marx shook his hand and shot back, "And I want to thank you for all the joy you've taken out of the world." Now, some might ask why we would devote an entire Sunday to laughing, telling jokes. There are hymns that are written that are to a familiar tune, but they're funny hymns, things like that. Well, the point of all of this is that the tomfoolery and all of that of Risus Pascalis reminds us that Christ is risen and that sin, death, and the devil have been vanquished. We celebrate, we laugh, sing, and dance. Now, next Sunday, we can go back to being God's frozen chosen. But this Sunday, we dance. A little bit of foolishness is nothing new for the church. Even Paul wrote to the Corinthians about the foolishness of the cross. The Romans and many Jews and Gentiles viewed the cross as a symbol of a horrific method of execution. They believed the cross symbol was used to strike terror in the minds of everyone who gazed upon those two pieces of wood fashioned together. How could such a thing be considered a symbol of God's love? This notion just seemed pure foolishness to the Greeks and the Romans and Jews alike. Well, Paul goes on to write that there is a problem trying to proclaim God's wisdom found in a cross when it seems so foolish to so many people. The Greeks worshiped God through wisdom and understanding. And the cross defied conventional wisdom and sounds like utter foolishness. The Greeks seek wisdom, Paul writes. The Jews seek a sign. And the cross does not work too well as a sign. It's a huge stumbling block since it's difficult to reconcile the idea of a Messiah dying on a tree with the concept of a triumphant Messiah. Instead, faithful Jews looked for other signs, and for many, the empty tomb was not enough of a sign. So Paul raises the question, has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Sometimes it's better just to be a fool for God than to try to be wise. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. What signs are people looking for today? Often, people seek a theology that fits them instead of being fitted or transformed by the gospel. Instead of trying to find a church that fits us, we might better be served searching for better signs. One sign might be when meals are prepared to feed the hungry in the community, like Meals on Wheels. Another sign might be shelter given to the homeless or those in dire straits. Another sign could be assistance provided to those in poor health. Signs abound when a church reaches out to the community outside its walls. If we're going to be looking for signs in churches, then these are the kind to look for. But another great sign is the sign of laughter. A church that can laugh is a church that understands the triumph of the resurrection and the enormous power of God. It is a church that understands that the smartest of humans and the most stunning accomplishments of humanity are foolish child's play for God. Psalm 126 refers to this kind of worship community. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. When we consider the great things that God has done for us and the reason we celebrate Easter, laughter and shouts of joy should bubble out of our mouths. God has done great things. God has left us an empty tomb as the punchline of the greatest prank ever played. Jesus rising from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus is no joke. We can imagine God's pleasure and even laughter when everyone thought death would overcome divine power and love. We can find humor in numerous places in the Bible if we look for it. Reread the Gospel of John, for example, when Jesus appears to the disciples and Thomas. Now think about it. The disciples had locked themselves in a room. They were afraid somebody would find them and turn them in as disciples of Jesus. So here they are hiding, hunkered down as it were. They are nervous. No, they're past nervous. They are scared. You know, perhaps, I don't know, Peter maybe, he was always bold, steps to a window and peeks through the curtains to peer down to the street below. Has anybody followed them? Then suddenly, somebody else is in the room. Could it be possible that Jesus might have thought about saying, boo, as he stepped out of the shadows? So it's no wonder Jesus said, peace be with you. Peace is exactly what they needed. Peeled to the ceiling, as they no doubt were. You know, we read elsewhere in the Bible that we're to make a joyful noise. What noise is more joyful than a good knee-slapping, hearty belly laugh? Studies show that laughter is good for your health. They're not really sure whether it's actually the act of laughing that makes people feel better or if it's having a good sense of humor, you know. Good sense of humor, a positive attitude, support of friends and family, all play a role in improving health. So, feel free to laugh at bad jokes, chuckle at the good ones, even share one or two later yourself. Many of us may not be wise by human standards at all, but that does not mean we need to drain the fun and laughter out of everything and be serious all the time. Being a Christian and following Christ is very serious, as is our commitment to God. But we need to remember that we are called to rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoicing means to be filled with joy, and that means being able to laugh at things sometimes. Just as God was probably laughing a little bit when everybody was there looking for Jesus in the empty tomb. God's great joke was that Jesus was not dead. He was alive again. Our Lord and Savior is risen. Be glad and rejoice and let out a good laugh. If God can make the wise look foolish and turn the fools into sages, then let us be fools for God any day. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Now, having heard the word of the Lord read and proclaimed, let us rise in body or in spirit as we are able and proclaim what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. God of grace, your Son moves through locked doors and into our places of fear. We are grateful for the peace Christ offers and his encouragement to continue along the path of faith, even when we face challenges and temptations. On this second Sunday of Easter, we call to mind your suffering people. Holy God, hear our prayers on behalf of those who are exhausted by their lives and carrying heavy loads, those whose fear and anxiety traps them in small places and small lives, those who are overwhelmed or depressed and cannot find their joy, those who need resurrection but are still stuck in the tomb. Mighty God, healer of nations, hear our prayers for peace and for nonviolent conflict resolution. Our world is torn apart by war, violence, and abuse. Holy God, hear our prayers on behalf of the people and country of Ukraine, Russian citizens conscripted into war, innocent lives destroyed and families torn apart by the madness of violence, political leaders prioritizing peace and nonviolent conflict resolution. God of hope, you resurrect us from our places of despair, turning us toward your promises of peace. Help us rejoice in the beauty that surrounds us. Help us attend to the gifts you abundantly provide. Holy God, hear our prayers of gratitude for the grace and support of loved ones who get us through difficult days, the joy of laughter, play, and good fun, your creation that awakens with springtime blooms, opportunities to follow Christ in meaningful service and lives of purpose. Ground us in your good news, O God, and keep our feet steady on Christ's path. May we return to worship you again and again, and to pray the prayer Christ taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debts. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Let us gratefully give of our offerings in praise of Christ's ministry through us and for us. And the offering plates are once again near the back doors. Let us pray. Risen and redeeming God, you have given us more than we could ever give you in return. You are gracious and generous in your love. Accept these offerings as signs of your gratitude and bless our work on Christ's behalf. May we love as Christ loved. May we serve as Christ served. Call us forth into your world, guided by Christ's Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
One final parting word. Knock, knock. Saul. Saul, there he is. There ain't no more. And now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the peace and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.